Let's start out like a good teacher interviewing the class. Who has followed a master course in general relativity? Yeah, as expected. Right, so the real hard part for many of you will be that I will start to sprinkle around GMU news, and anybody who has followed that course knows what GMU news is, but many of you have only a sort of vague idea of what general relativity is. So perhaps this is not really like this teaching 90 minutes, but it's more like a book promotion event, believe it or not. We have literally worked our ass off to serve to the community, right? So this is a development that started about 8 years ago, perhaps. And it was really like a revolutionary type of thing, which, you know, in an extremely rapid pace, one after the other, unexpected result followed. And it's now sort of settling down, sort of slower than it used to be in the last year. I'm not aware that anything really big happened. So it was a good time to write a book about it, which is really meant to be a textbook. But a textbook that serves several types of customers. It serves basically, in first instance, you. Those people that find GR a bit scary, that find string theory extremely scary, but still want to know what's going on, right? So there's sort of an outer layer in the book that's very descriptive. It's mostly text, not many equations. Hopefully you can read it in an airplane, have a good time reading it, because it's a good thriller. And there's a next level that is physically in a book like text boxes, where even the most ambitious graduate student can learn to do these calculations all by him or herself. Right? They get all the gory details of the gravitational calculations, including even Mathematica codes that you can find on the website to do the hardest work. So the page proofs are lying there, at least one quarter of the book I had to correct is already done. And it's basically sure that it will appear October 28, 2015 on Amazon. So I hope that all of you will buy a copy, because two of
e-book?
Us.
Is there an e-book?
There will be an e-book too. Cambridge is automatically releasing e-book versions.
Free e-book.
I hope so. I don't know. They do the business end. Right, so there are two senior authors. It's myself and my dear friend and string theory comrade Koenraad Schalm. And there are two people who really need the money. It will be very little, of course. Yao and Sun and Yan Liu, they are Chinese postdocs who are basically heading back to China. And I hope they can land a good job out there based on the book. Let's hope for the best. So when you all buy this book, they will land a good job there. And that's a reason to spend 80 euros, perhaps. Anyhow, so all I can do in these 90 minutes is give really sort of an overview of what it is about. And I plan to do the following thing. The first half hour, I want to get across the sort of big picture, where it is, what the context is, where it comes from, etc., in terms of a picture show using my laptop. And then the next half hour, I would like to go to these pseudo blackboards there that don't really work that well, in order to present you sort of an impression of how the computations go. And on special request of my dear friend Jörg Smalion, because at an earlier occasion I gave a 25-minute talk at the meeting, and Jörg, during the dinner, told me, you know, I've seen more of these talks, and all I get out of it is sort of pictures of the face of Einstein, and I would like to know what's there behind. There are equations there. Why don't you show equations? So that's what I want to do, and it just giving you an impression of how the mechanics works. Then I will get back to what really matters, and that are the applications, and that's about what it has to tell about physics of the kind of this meeting, say metal, holographic superconductivity in Fermi liquids, transport. Nigel was already alluding to it. I will be very short, actually. I hope that Philip Phillips will drill down a bit deeper in that, and then this is really sort of my thing, linking the string theory business to quantum matter, entanglement, and so forth. So I hope I have some time for it, because that's where my heart and ego reside at the moment. Okay. String theory, scary business, where extremely big mathematical minds like Ed Witten has been contributing a lot. It's about beautiful equations that are supposed to tell something about the most fundamental questions of the universe, like what's the origin of space-time, that kind of stuff. In a way, it's a bit of a dramatic story because it started out about 40 years ago, and all of us, of course, know that this was really flourishing in the 1990s and so forth. But right now, when you dwell in restaurants with string theory, they will tell that they don't feel themselves any longer string theory because string theory has completely stalled and it's turned into something else. That something else is, at least when it comes to physics, surprisingly much oriented towards condensed matter questions. Right? What is going on deep behind this? The string theory started out as the pursuit of the ultimate reductionism, having one beautiful equation that explains everything, and has turned into a continuation of the Landau school of physics, or statistical physics. It's all about emergent phenomena, and that's our territory. Right? And that's where the physics is, that's where the experiments are. There's surely a sentiment in that community that after all these years, they could never connect the equations to things happening in nature. And now with condensed matter physics, there's certainly that new chance to make it work. And factually, it's closer to experiment than it ever has been before. I saw the sentiment in the string theory community. When it started in 2007, in no time it exploded in a real mainstream affair in the string theory community. And to make the case, I have here a picture gallery of prominent senior people who have been working on it. It's much a community effort. There's not a single person who's done it, but a lot of persons who have contributed to it. It's like Joe Polsinski, who's sort of the number two on the pecking order list of the string theorists after Witten, Shamit Kajrul from Stanford, Steiner from Oxford, Erdmanger from the MPI Munich, Kupser from Princeton, Horowitz from Santa Barbara, Silverstein from Stanford, Kantler from MPI College, Paul Castro from Nicole Normale Supérieure in Paris, David Tong from Cambridge, Tom Son, who is now at the University of Chicago, John Hartnell, which is the number one officially in ADS-CMT story, who is now in Stanford, Chris Herzog, Stony Brook, Alan Adams, MIT, John McGreevy, UCSB, Hong Liu, MIT, Kuan Song is my dear friend in Leiden, Andreas Clark, University of Washington, and there you see three faces, of which two faces are here. That's Philip, he will be next, and me. And also especially Subir Sachdev. I mean, it's really Subir set it going. Right? So when Effer Nobel Prize has to go, Subir is right now the first on that list on the condensed matter side. So the only three of us are really hardcore senior condensed matter people. There's a reason for it, because it's pretty hard to learn that language. We have learned it, it's sort of a big fun, and I try to lure friends to pay attention to it. I know it's hard because it takes a lot of effort. I just got into it for accidental circumstances, and I can tell you in a wine stupid tonight how it happened. So, what is the claim? What's sort of the central claim made in this business? It's about our kind of stuff, high-TC superconductors. I will get back to the discovery of science later. Right? We all know it's about these interesting electron systems playing highly collective quantum mechanical games that we don't quite understand that well. We measure them by photon emission and so forth. And it produces abstract patterns, and we're not quite sure what it all means. And now come the string theorists and say, oh, not a big deal. In these 40 years, we have developed a mathematical machinery that works in the following way. Imagine there's an infinitely large universe, and that universe is basically like our universe. It's about planets and stars and black holes, and you're attracted by gravity to these planets and so forth. And the odd part of this universe is that it has an outside, and then this quantum matter stuff is living on this outside, and we want to decipher what it is about. What you're then supposed to do is take a spaceship, travel into this gravitational universe, and you land in the middle of it, and you find there a black hole. And the red grid is the horizon of the black hole, the event horizon. I will come back to that. And near the horizon, you find these interesting light effects. Some of you might have seen the movie Interstellar and might know that Kip Thorne, the famous relativist, was actually an advisor or a co-producer of it. And you might have seen these beautiful pictures of the lensing of light due to black hole gravitational fields. This picture is actually coming, or this movie is coming, from a suggestion by Kip when he was visiting Professor Leiden, and I asked him whether he had a movie for the kind, and he gave me this movie. So this is basically the predecessor of Interstellar. And what you see here is the light of a blue star accompanied by a little brown and yellow star that is lensed by the warp space-time near the horizon of the black hole. Now, so you say, so we see these light effects, and now we have a very indirect but very precise mathematical tool that translates these light effects near the horizon of black holes into the behavior of this quantum matter. When you see this claim for the first time, you should decide that this is outrageous, right? So string theories are these physicists who take a lot of LSD before they do a computation, that's their reputation. When you start to learn it, it starts to make more and more and more sense. And that's basically what I want to explain to you in the remaining time. In a way, there's a much deeper story behind it, and I'm myself really excited about it. I'm an old and very cynical physicist. I've seen many things in my life. But the fact is that I haven't been as excited about things moving in physics at large as I've been recently, because it's really about, you have these different fields of physics. You have our condensed matter physics. You have the string theory of black hole physics business. And last but not least, there's also this invasion of quantum information, and they all seem to get together in sort of a new wholeness that nobody expects, that bears the promise of scientific evolution. It's a bit like living in the 1920s or something, and you know that the discovery of quantum mechanics, Schrödinger, iceberg and so forth might be around the corner. Perhaps it's a delusion, nothing is proven here, but it's a real great adventure in physics at large. The role of condensed matter physics is really like it's not said that electrons in copper, rust and so forth can do this job, but let's hope they do it, that they can contribute to this evolution of physics at large, stuff that might be remembered in 100 years from now as really a leap forward in this understanding of nature. So from the condensed matter point of view, sometimes you get the impression that all the hard work has been done by our forefathers, mostly in the 1950s. But actually that's not true. And this is sort of a secret in the community, at least among the theorists. Actually, there is an enormous problem out there. And factually, we don't know what we're doing as theoretical physicists. All we have is mathematics. Experimentalists have the machines in the laboratory that don't lie, but we have only math. And math is like laboratory instruments. It has limitations. The claim is that about all what matters in 20th century physics eventually rest on this 19th century equation, which is the partition sum by Boltzmann, right? It's the origin of statistical physics, and all of you know that this explains the way that classical matter behaves, liquids, solids, and so forth. But then in the 1950s, it was figured out by Feynman, and actually earlier by Kramers, who was also a Leiden person, that the same partition sum can be used with great effect to solve quantum many-body problems. It's called a path integral. And we like in particularly the so-called thermal path integral, where you basically do nothing else than you continue our time, which is Minkowski or Lorentz time, to imaginary time. It's also called Euclidean time. And there you can write the quantum partition sum for systems at a finite temperature and also at zero temperature. It's just a sum over world histories, where you now balance the action associated with the world history with h bar, right? You have, again, this probabilistic problem. When you can use this recipe, we are mighty. We, as physicists, have computed the difference between the proton and the neutron mass using the lattice QCD, using big computers. And that's, of course, extremely glorious that we have managed to do that. And there's a problem described with this kind of structure. The truth of the matter is, this is not generic. It's actually a pretty rare circumstance in physics that a quantum problem has this probabilistic structure. generically, there are these alternating signs, these negative probabilities in the partition sum. At the moment that these things pop up, we are in principle blind. This is mathematically extremely ill-behaved. There are no general solutions. And it's typically known in our community as a fermion sign problem. At the moment you're dealing with fermions at a finite density, when you say it precisely, these are described by alternating partition sums where the signs are coding for the fermion statistics. When the fermion system is very weakly interacting, we know what to do, but when it's strongly interacting, in general, we have not a single solution. The numerical people are complaining about it because the computers force them to be honest, but also when you're a paper and pencil guy, you're really blind. This problem has been worked under the rug for a long time. It's very nasty, and therefore, serious don't like to talk about it. We live in an era that I think everybody is getting more and more aware that this is really that number one problem in contemporary physics, solving the sign problem. Perhaps, yeah, so when we're dealing with fermions, we know what we do it all the time. We have two tricks. One trick is called, let's declare our fermions to renormalize in a non-interacting fermionic gas of quasar particles. That is the Fermi liquid, and they have a Fermi surface, and all the time we seem to see everywhere Fermi surfaces. And the other trick is just the mean field theory of the BCS kind, right, including charge density waves and spin density waves. I like to call it Hartree-Fock, like many other people like to call it Hartree-Fock. This also works greatly, and we can explain how spontaneous symmetry breaking happens associated with fermion bilinears. And this is our repertoire. Everything else is, you know, show diagrams at it and hope that somehow things are perturbative in these constructions. We have, frankly, also nature on our side that keeps us honest. And, you know, to my strong opinion, that whole business of high TC-related phenomena, subject of this meeting, is eventually about we see these workers of the fermion signs and we just know that we are very confused. The theory is mis-equations. Perhaps to emphasize something else, in February this year, we landed a review paper in Nature. There's supposed to be a bit of a consensus document, basically trying to find a consensus about what the problem of high TC superconductivity is about, what the problems are that are no longer real problems, and what the real problems are that should be worked on in the near future. And of course, you know all these names. At least the three theorists, Steve Giffelson, Mike Norman, and me, were kind of single opinion that the real trouble is the theorists have to come up with new equations. Right? We need new mathematical tools to get anywhere. So I recommend you to read it, and when you don't agree, you know, send us hate mail. The Nature editor was very surprised that so little hate mail was coming. But that's just interesting because it's scientific debate. Okay, this is the subject of the meeting. I don't have to tell anything about it. Linear stiffness, you're all familiar with it. For future purposes, I just want to show you one cartoon. It's a joke, but I like the joke. And that is about that thing called quantum criticality, where many people believe that's sort of at the core of our business. And just to amplify that notion of quantum criticality, it's a very profound notion. And I find that this cartoon highlights the depth of it. This cartoon starts out with a piece of vegetable that you can eat. It's a kind of a cauliflower. However, you can now take a piece of this cauliflower, magnify this factor 10, and look at it again, and it looks still like a vegetable. But now you can repeat this operation, and it looks like this. And perhaps you think it's still looking like just a vegetable, but when you can repeat, the magnification operation looks like this. This is a fractal cauliflower, and these are real photographs on the real different scales of this cauliflower. This is a scale invariant, or in other words, a fractal, or in other words, a critical cauliflower. And when you know this, next time you see it in the supermarket, you buy it because you won't have this pleasure that you tea slices through all these layers of organization. I find it a very, you know, lovely feeling that teeth can crunch this. So, what the heck has this to do with electrons in superconductors and black holes? Imagine that this is more interesting stuff than vegetable. And it's about stuff that's made out of highly quantum mechanical things like electrons. You do the magnification, you end up at the Lattice scale. And at the Lattice scale, all of us know that these electrons are behaving in an extremely quantum mechanical way. And quantum mechanics means Schrodinger catness. It also means quantum computers, entanglement, and the whole business. And now we insist that everything is gain invariance, including the workings of H-bar. So we zoom out to a larger scale, and H-bar transforms like everything else. We zoom out to even larger scales. We get at a microscopic scale. And this quantum cauliflower is behaving quantum mechanically in the same way on a macroscopic scale as it did on the microscopic scale. At least Zubir and me like to argue that this is the most quantum mechanical state of macroscopic matter that mankind has identified. Right? So all the entanglements and so forth that make the micro world so interesting are projected on the macro world. Part of the trouble is that we find it hard to describe these type of entanglements in a mathematical form, and so it gets a bit more hairy than the simplest quantum mechanical state. I show this because this is really that bridge between the black holes and our business. ADS-CFT is really dealing all the time with quantum mechanical states, and I will explain that at length. Oops, I'm already on the way for nearly half an hour. That stinks. Okay, let's switch gear and go to string theory. Right, so string theory was born in high energy physics, and one way to understand the birth is you have this horrible standard model, which has all these different particles. It's a big mass. It has 32 free parameters, or 41, I forgot. And of course, the high energy series didn't like it because our Lord is an elegant person who makes things very, very beautiful, at least to the mathematical eye. And they figured out that, you know, instead of thinking that you have all these particles, let's think there's a single string out there, a little string that behaves in very quantum mechanical matters. And like a guitar string, it can vibrate in different ways. And when you make this string very tiny, then we might think that's like a particle, and every string vibration is yet another particle. So you need one string, and you can do all particles. That was thought number one. And thought number two, that was perhaps more important in the history of the subject, is when you now start to study the quantum mechanical theory of these extended objects, you find out in no time that gravity is part of this world. When you do closed strings, they have a lot of dealings with general relativity. The relations are often kind of indirect. They are not as easy as you would wish, but they are there, and it's sort of a surprise thing when you start to study string theory. After three lectures or something, you find yourself all the time solving Einstein equations. Right? So this really coming rolling out of the mathematics. It's hard to explain in intuitive terms. Right, so the string theory exploded in the early 1980s, also anomaly cancellation, blah, 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 blah. And all high energy theories that had a big ego started to do it. And then in the late 80s, early 90s, a crisis developed because they hoped for a single consistent string theory as ultimate reductionist. And they find like five consistent string theories, and they were very unhappy with that. And then in 1995, there was this seminal event where Ed Witten, the great guru, gave a speech at the string conference explaining that all these different string theories were actually semi-classical limits associated with an underlying structure called M theory that were all in dual relation, and because of this web of dualities, you could be sure about the fact that M theory exists, although you don't know what it is. A very weird thing that you know that the theory exists, but you can't tell what it is, but that you do by duality webs. In the aftermath, Joe Polsinski came up with the notion that in string theory, you don't only have these strings, but you have also higher dimensional extended objects called brains. Right? So like a pea brain is an object having p spatial dimensions and one extra time dimensions hanging in a 10 or 11 dimensional space of fundamental string theory. And then there's more going on, but the bottom line is that there was a young, very brilliant theorist that started to play around with it, and he figured out that he could relate basically a black hole-like structure made out of closing with pure gravity to a construction associated with brains and open strings, and that these were yet again in an open closed string duality relation. Again, the word duality. And he could push this to a point that it really turned into something that's as close to Fermi mathematics as you can imagine in the absence of real mathematicians, telling us that there's a precise duality between supergravity in the classical limit, compactified on the ADS5 cos S5, and a maximally supersymmetric Yang-Mills theory living in four space-time dimensions under conditions that the n is large. I will explain n in some detail, hopefully, when I have the time. And the toothed coupling has to be very large. I will explain these things in a bit more detail later. That's a sort of special limit of a field theory. And this is the famous ADS-CFT correspondence that was discovered in 1997. And then a year later, Witten and Kupsipolikov-Klebanov came up with a follow-up paper that sort of decoded the construction in its full magnitude. And it exploded into sort of the main activity on string theory floor since then. Right? So it's like 10,000 papers are written doing all kinds of consistency checks and applying it to all kinds of things, including the condensed matter bit. The deep morale of ADS-CFT is there are these two grand theories of physics, which is general relativity and quantum field theory, that usually have a pretty uneasy relation. Right? They seem to be not the best friends at all, and there are lots of paradoxes and so forth associated with it. But Balassini showed that under certain conditions that will be explained, there are just two sides of the same coin. It's one thing. Depending how you look at it, it appears to you as gravity or as quantum field theory. It's a duality thing. And that is the basic machinery that's now imported to condensed matter physics, because we are interested in quantum field theory, quantum many-body problems. And it's just discovered by fooling around, by doing experiments, that this works so well for our type of problems. Not saying that it solves our problems, but from the point of view of theoretical physics, that is where this thing has been most productive. Okay, duality. That is all the time central in this way of doing mathematics. And duality is really like particle wave duality. That's really the meaning of the word duality. Right, so the most primitive form of duality you find in Chinese Taoism, as yin and yang symbol, saying that opposites form a harmonious whole that explains the universe. Like you have yin, and that's cat, yang is dog. Yin is cold, yang is hot. Yin is female, yang is male. That's how it is explained by Chinese friends, as the way you apply it is, you live near the North Korean border. There is hot, is cold, so it's yin. To get in harmony with the universe, you have to compensate by eating yang, and therefore you have to eat dog. You go to Guangdong, or Canton in the south. There, the climate is hot, is yang. To compensate for that and to get in harmony with the universe, you have to eat yin, in other words, cat. And that's the reason that people eat in Guangdong cat and near the North Korean border, dog. Okay, so this is stylized gibberish to cite another friend of mine. Let's go to the ways it works in physics, and there it gets no nonsense. All of you have learned quantum mechanics, and you know that your particle wave description, you know they are each other opposites. There's a Fourier transformation in between. But you also know that you better know the both opposite sides, the particle and wave sides, to really understand what's going on, right? So the wholeness of quantum mechanics is both particle and hole, and it's pent up by the opposites. The sense of duality you have to appreciate to understand ADS-CFT is field-theoretical, weak-strong, or Kramers 1J duality. Who has learned Kramers 1J duality for the two-dimensional Ising model? Stick up your finger. Again, a thing that all physicists should know, but unfortunately, we don't always teach it. This goes back to the 1940s, and it's about a simple Ising model in two dimensions. And then you say, okay, I have the high temperature phase, and from the point of view of a field theory, it's a strongly coupled phase. It's a violently fluctuating mass. And you want to describe it. And then you realize that you can describe this in terms of domain ball operators, things that disorder the ordered Ising spins. And the high temperature state can be as well described as, in essence, a condensate of domain walls. And that condensate is, again, like an ordered phase, actually described mathematically, there's just a mathematical algebraic description out here, in terms of dual Ising spins. Right? So you have the two opposites. You have the world of very tranquil ordered Ising spins, that's the low temperature world. You have sort of the opposite, the high temperature Ising world where everything fluctuates like hell. But you can read the opposite, the high temperature world, in terms of domain wall variables, in terms of these variables, it would come to you as a very ice cold, very boring world where nothing happens. That's the notion of weak strong duality in essence. Right, there's a big history in field theory, in condensed matter physics. Some of you might know the vortex duality, that's all the time used by my dear friend Sento, who's sitting there, which is in essence the same construction. It's again a weak strong duality. And in field theory, you have scores and scores of these weak strong dualities, and usually they're quite a bit more interesting than Ising, because Ising is self-dual, you get the same theory. Usually you relate very different theories by a duality transformation. The most extreme version of this is ADS-CFT. Right, so the gravitational world is the weakly coupled tranquil world where nothing happens. The field theoretical world is very strongly coupled, and that's hugely complicated fluctuating mass. And ADS-CFT is relating them as if you're dealing with low temperature and high temperature state of Ising. Then you look at how it works. Then you find on the field theory, strongly coupled side, that it describes impeccably the behaviors of thermal matter. It encloses all of statistical physics, all of classical thermodynamics. It encloses also the way that dissipative matter works, Navier-Stokes hydrodynamics at a finite temperature. But you can also use it to address zero temperature matter, call it quantum fields, call it quantum matter. It's all in there. And this is all dual to general relativity. Now, what the heck is general relativity doing here? But it's clearly a big step further than a normal field theoretical strong weak duality. This is that famous equation, the Einstein equation. When you have taken the GR course, you have done zillions of exercises. Otherwise, you are supposed to know that this is not the most important, but the most beautiful equation of physics, relating how space and time behaves as sort of a kind of material system, but not quite. It's this fabric thing that you can curve and cut and do. And there's an extremely beautiful if sign here, saying that it is in a perfect correspondence with the opinions of matter and energy, right, encoded in a stress energy tensor. And now you have a nice equation that you're supposed to solve, and it tells you how universes and so forth work. So this goes back to 1915, and then there was in 1972 a next revolution out here due to the man in the wheelchair, who just took the space-times of classical general relativity. He considered the simple Schwarzschild black hole and asked the question, what happens when I promote that vacuum to the vacuum of a quantum field theory that's this boiling pot of virtual processes, like you have these electrons and positrons popping out of the vacuum and getting back again. And he figured out that, oops, is that me? No, that's fortunately not me. I stay composed. And the man figured out that when you combine this notion of the vacuum of the field theory with the horizon, that is black hole, which is an object purely made out of space and time, there's no energy and matter involved, starts to behave like a material object. It starts to behave like a light bulb radiating black body radiation. Right? So this black hole has somehow, in combination with quantum field theory, a real material aspect as well. Given that this thing has a temperature, it also should have an entropy. And entropy means that you can count the number of degrees of freedom of the object. And early on, it was already realized, actually before Hawking, Pakistan realized that the black hole entropy should scale with the area of the horizon. So the way to think about it is, you take the event of the horizon of the black hole, you divide it in little boxes of size Planck scale, you put one bit of information in it, right? And then you count the entropy of this, and that is the entropy of the black hole. It's extremely weird because objects in this room, including myself and all of you, have an entropy, a number of degrees of freedom that scales with your volume. When you're twice as fat, you have twice as many molecules, agreed. But not so when you're dealing with these quantum gravitational things. Somehow the number of degrees of freedom of a gravitational object like a black hole scales with the area. So you've lost a dimension when you want to see this thing as a material thing like you and me. This was lifted to a principle, it's the holographic principle, by first set by Gerhard Hooft and later by Lenny Susskind, with some interesting things to add. Asserting that when you're dealing with gravitational theory, quantum gravitational theory, it always needs to live in one higher dimension than an equivalent field theory slash statistical physics, whatever else you think is normal. And that is acting out as this next big principle in ADS-CFT. So it's called holographic duality nowadays, instead of the ADS-CFT correspondence about duality, Weak strong duality, but holographic, because normal holography is a pretty good metaphor to understand how it works. So how this normal holography works, you have this photographic plate in two dimensions. When you look at it, it has very complicated interference fringes. You shine through a laser beam, and because it lights coherence, it reconstructs an object that's hanging there in three-dimensional space, like this little tiger. Right? So this plate is encoding for this three-dimensional information. Right? And that's really the way it acts out in ADS-CFT. So the gravitational theory is about a space with one higher dimension than the stuff you're interested in the field theory. I can actually look at it as the boundary of that higher dimensional space. I will explain that in a moment why that is. So your quantum field theoretical stuff lives on this flat space-time associated with the boundary of the field theory, right? And it's all living in one lesser dimension. It's the boundary. This bulk having one extra dimension is encoding this stuff in terms of gravitational physics, where the advantage of classical general relativity is there's a lot more intuitive to humans than quantum field theory. Right? So quantum field theory is like these complicated fringes, and relativity is like this tiger that is smiling at you. It's also true mathematically. Right? So the duality is you encode extremely strongly coupled quantum matter in the language of classical general relativity, and now you use the mathematical powers of general relativity to basically very systematically figure out what can happen in this gravitational bulk, and then to translate that in things happening in this quantum field theory. And surprisingly, this machine is really doing the Landau-Boltzmann job. It's about revealing emergence principle. In principles, the whole is a lot more than the sum of the parts, right? And you get sort of a generalization of our trade of condensed matter physics is all about these effective field theories, whatever, that describe the behavior of macroscopic matter, where that macroscopic matter is largely forgotten where it's made from. The last ingredient is one that we'll be figuring in these 20 minutes I have to do my improvised blackboard show. And it's about the way this hangs together with the idea of the normalization group. So the gravitational space has a structure, and it's called anti-de Sitter in its most primitive form of ADS CFT. ADS anti de Sitter. And anti de Sitter is just a solution of Einstein equation with negative cosmological constant. I will get back to that. I will write some equations later. But the way to remember that is just look at this painting of Escher, and you see that this is an infinitely large place that is still an outside. And that makes it possible to let the field theory live on this outside. Given that this is such a nice picture, you always tell that, the quantum field theory associated with this geometry in the bulk has to be quantum critical. But it is the fractal Fechi with H bar. It's special quantum critical. It is also conformal, which means that angles don't change under scale transformations. Right, so this very elementary ADS CFT correspondence was relating. This was really discovered by Modestine, and it was relating this geometrical anti de Sitter space to quantum criticality. But the string series used a different word, conformal field theory, so it took a little while to realize that we were obsessing about the same basic stuff. So here is the first deep relation with quantum criticality. There's something very deep behind it. You always somehow infer that there's something fractal going on here. This is related to the so-called isometries of this geometry and ADS, as I will explain on the blackboard in a minute from now, has a isometry that translates precisely in the conformal invariance of the boundary field theory. The beauty is that it explains the meaning of this extra dimension you have going from the outside to the deep interior of this gravitational space. Right? So this is the real extra dimension you pick up on the gravitational side as the scaling dimension of the field theory. Right? So all of you should know something about normalization. So you integrate out short distance degrees of freedom. When you do that, you see it's changing, it's flowing. And in ADS-CFT, you geometrize that process. You just look at the geometry in the bulk and you see how classical fields propagate in this bulk. And you get differential equations of GR origin. And they are just coincident with the famous differential equations that govern the running of coupling constants in the field theory. And this is really the thing I can explain quickly on the improvised blackboard. Right, so bulk ADS geometry is coding for scaling invariance of the field theory, and this is called GR is RG. General relativity is renormalization group. So you geometrize the renormalization group. The way to think about it in a somewhat different picture is like all of you know about decimating real space when you do renormalization group series. So you take degrees of freedom together on a plaquette here, you make a new degree of freedom out of it, and you get a coarse grain, and so forth. Right? And it's much like this geometry, right, of the anti de Sitter space where you think about this as this extra radial direction. This I will explain better. Up to this point, I've just told you about these sort of very qualitative principles, weak strong duality, holographic principle, and GR is RG. But actually, ADS-CFT is really a mathematical machine. It's basically like a Fourier transformation, but one with a lot of turbo boosters and compressors attached to it. And this was an accomplishment by Kupser, Klebanov, Polyakov, / Witten, a year after a Modestine's paper, who wrote down a very general rule how to associate things happening in the boundary field theory to things happening in the gravitational bulk. And here it is. I will explain it a bit more using the improvised blackboard in a minute. I'll also explain what this large N limit is doing there. Right? And that makes it possible to basically rely on symmetry principles, the way GR works, and this dictionary to have a pretty tight computational scheme. It's remarkably constrained. You cannot fool around with this. You get just merciless solutions you cannot negotiate with. So there is a big menace when you want to apply this to silly electrons in cooperators, matrix large N. I will explain it. And it's all about the fact that in order to really make this work, what you need to do is that your microscopic degrees of freedom are things that are matrix fields, and the matrices have to be extremely large to really be able to trust it mathematically. And these short distance degrees of freedom is not quite of the kind that we see in cuprates, these silly cuprate electrons. It's widely believed, but not proven in any way, that there is this UV independence, as the string theory call it, and that is our synchronous metaphysics strong emergence. Right? The whole is more than the sum of the parts, more is different. When you stack lots and lots of microscopic things together, they start to behave in completely new ways that forget completely about what the microscopic actors were. And it seems that this acts out, but it's more like an experimental fact than really understood. So keep in mind that ADS-CFT is by itself still pretty mysterious. The essence is that it works a lot better than it should, and nobody really knows why that is. And I will explain why it works a lot better than it should a little later. Okay, it's time to switch to the blackboard. And I'm not sure whether I can get this done, because the material I have will take an hour of scribbling equations. I want to see how far I get. I will want to do at least the first part. Are there any questions at this point? Probably so general that it's impossible to ask any question. Now I need the light, because I have to enlighten the audience with these flip-flop things. I need some water. Okay, I'm going to show some equations. Now it gets more serious. Further up front, right? Yeah. The issue I have is that they move. They roll. Yeah. Something like that, yeah. I start writing. This one is not rolling, so I can already write something. Everybody understands these statements that I just scribbled down on these flip-flops? It's sort of this thing that any serious learns at the party, but experimentalists sometimes find it scary. So you want to do your quantum antibody problem, and then you say, I do this path integral sum over world history. This is action out here. And this action is an integral over imaginary time that goes from 0 to h bar beta. Beta is 1 over kbt. Space dimension, Lagrangian density. Lagrangian density is like this Ginzburg-Landau CUE, where all you do is you add an extra time derivative term. Right? So the basic statement is quantum physics is just statistical physics in space-time. But then you have to do an operation called Wick rotation, because this time is imaginary, and then you have to analytical TU imaginary time to real time, and then you get to see anything you wish to know about your quantum physics. One thing I will need later is right, so you have all space directions, and then there's this weird thing that you want to compute things at a finite temperature. And what you're supposed to do is roll up this imaginary time direction into a circle, there's a radius, and it goes like h bar divided by kBT. So when temperature is very small, this is an enormous circle. When it's infinite, the circle is infinitely large, and you do zero temperature quantum physics. And when you raise temperature, that circle is shrinking. Right? So temperature takes the role of finite size scaling, you know, from statistical physics. Extremely efficient formulas called thermal field theory, and theory is used all the time. Okay, so I depart from this, and now I start to read aloud out of super exhaustive books about quantum phase transitions. And you want now to compute propagators in the field theory. What you're supposed to do is compute a two-point correlator, statistical physics style, in Euclidean space-time. Let's go to zero temperature. R is square root of x squared plus tau squared. I take the liberty to consider a Lorentz invariant polar, meaning that space and time behave in the same way in Euclidean space-time. And this is just a distance in Euclidean space-time. And now we insist that next to Lorentz invariance, there's also this scale invariance, this conformal invariance. Now you learn in set FIST that when you have this critical state, that all correlators, just check that are consistent notations, have to behave like power laws. And when you have an interesting, so this is delta phi, that is this exponent, that is the operator, the exponent is the dimension associated with the operator. And when you have a real interesting critical state, this number is typically not like one. It's some weird rational number. There's an anomalous dimension. Now you Wick rotate, meaning you do that analytical continuation in your Fourier transform, and that delivers to you the propagator that all of us write all the time on the blackboard, which is a thing which is a function of frequency and momentum. And because this algebraic expression, this also turns into an algebraic expression. There's just this thing going on that there's a minus sign associated with frequency, and this has scaling dimension d minus 2 delta, and I behave like a high energy physicist. Big D is the dimension of space and time, right? So small d is space dimensions. In other words, when you have conformal or scaling invariance and Lorentz invariance in space-time, or in your quantum problem, you know exactly how the two-point correlator works. But all you need to know is this anomalous dimension. Now, these things are weird because they don't contain particles. Particles are little poles, right? So when you look at the imaginary part of this, you get a spectral function. And okay, this is literally like a relative physics system. You get for fermions a similar statement. And when you have a particle, you actually have here a pole sitting, right? This is omega is ck, we are like graphene. And you have a self-energy, so there can be a hell of a lot of junk at higher energies. But dealing with this critical state, there's no such thing as a particle state. What you find instead is, so let's go to precisely Ku0, and then you find something that looks like 1 over omega to the power d minus 2 delta. Right? It's a power law form. This we call branch cuts, and I like Philip Phillips' campaign to call these unparticles. And what it really tells us is a particle is an object where you can first localize the quantum number that you insert in the system, exciting it in a little tiny volume of space and time, and then, you know, draw all world lines of this little lump. And when you do that, you will find out that you get this pole in the spectrum. We have a real interesting, strongly interacting quantum critical state. You can't do it because scaling invariance rules, and you start out putting that thing in this little tiny volume of space and time, but you're supposed to do a scaling invariance, leaving everything irrelevant. You do it, and your quantum number is spread out of your volume. Right? So there are really no particles in this theory. Okay. So you go to a finite momentum, and then you can see from the expression that there's no imaginary part until you hit the light cone, and then you will see something of this kind. I need this because I want to compute this using Einstein equations. That's area CFT. Okay. So somehow I want to compute this thing departing from the thing I learned from Modestina, that there is this entity-city space with one extra dimension. And now I start to think, how can I make that? And I learned about Einstein theory, at least I did, and you write down the so-called Hilbert Einstein action. It's very scary for those people who haven't followed the course. And I'm going to do it officially because I want to give you a sense of real equations. Einstein-Hilbert looks like this. R is the so-called Ricci scalar, telling us about an invariant associated with the geometry. Lambda is a cosmological constant, and all matter is the Lagrangian associated with the energy and matter stuff living in space-time. Now you can just say there's no energy and matter out there, and have only that lambda. When I take positive lambda, the space-time described by this action, when I do the Einstein manipulations, is the Sitter space, and that's our place. We live in the Sitter space. That's a dark energy thing, right? That the universe is expanding right now is because this number is somewhat positive. Anti the Sitter, right? So the Sitter is like a sphere, and anti the Sitter is its opposite thing. It's an hyperboloid, and that you get when you take negative lambda, right? You derive equation of motion from the action. You solve this Einstein equation. You solve it. And there you find a solution going back to my predecessor in Leiden, except that you have to add anti, and it looks like this. I know that when you haven't learned GR, this is complete hocus pocus, but it's a bit on purpose that you know that there are real equations all over the place. R is this radial direction going from the inside to the outside of that space, and it's the extra dimension. Eta mu nu is just a flat Minkowski metric. These are space and time directions, right? And then you multiply your space and time directions with a factor R over L, where R is the extra radial direction. L is the so-called ADS radius, the number you have to establish how big that ADS space is. And you do the opposite thing for your radial coordinate. And this describes this Escher picture when you want to visualize it. Now you look at this, and you find out that you can do a scale transformation. So x mu being at either space or time, Lorentz invariant, so it doesn't matter. You rescale with a factor lambda. And you look at the metric, you find out that thing stays invariant when you renormalize that by a factor 1 over lambda instead. And this really nails it down as the scaling direction associated with this critical state. Right? Because these are called isometries, because these isometries are acting out in the bulk. That geometry is automatically describing something that's scale invariant. When you try to interpret this as something that's only living on these space-time slices near the outside of the space. And so there's this deep relationship between the conformal symmetry in the boundary, in the quantum theory in the boundary, and the geometrical isometries of this entity-sitter space that was known by the mathematicians. When you want to understand this, look at this Escher picture, right? That's really your eyes tell directly that this is going on. Oops. Okay. Now, I'm this ignorant person like you that has learned that Modestine has figured out that somehow I can encode the boundary conformal field theory in terms of classical general relativity, and I wonder myself how to do it. So I started doing an experiment. So it should be classical stuff in the bulk, otherwise I get lost. And let's just write down sort of the simplest thing that I can interrogate the space-time. And the simplest thing is, in essence, this theory that I now embed in this curved space-time. So what I have to do is, I have to add here, let me see, yes, d to the power x d plus 1. I have now one extra dimension, the real direction. And then I have the square root of minus j because it's curved. And then you look in your GR book and you learn that the field theory in the curved space-time is written like, really small phi square plus dot, 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 dot. Right, so these gradients pick up these metric factors. Now you look again in your GR book, and it teaches you that the equation of motion associated with classical field reads like 1 over square root of minus g del mu square root of minus g g mu nu del mu phi minus m squared phi squared is 0. But it would be normally this box, but now these gradients get a kick because space-time is curved. I'm missing a mu because I, wait a moment, it should be a nu. G mu mu nu. This should be a nu. Agreed? Thanks, Luke. You make the case that this is not complete hocus pocus, but actually completely sane mathematics. Good. So this interesting equation and solving field equations in curved space-time is kind of hard work. Usually you fail in getting anywhere. Yeah, it is also there, but let's do free fields, let's just ignore it. Phi is now an infinitesimal probe field, and because field magnitude is approaching zero, you can ignore the self-interaction. It's classical, it's on-shell, tree-level stuff in the field theory language. Right now it's real, but you can make it complex. Field equation won't change. You will see in a moment that the basic ADS-CFT construction is not dependent on it. Right, so you can do all kinds of field theory, scalar, complex, vector. At some point, you know, you get more complicated equations, although an ADS itself is always sort of the same thing. Okay. Yeah. Now you can try to solve this. So in the first step, you Fourier transform your space-time, keeping R just in position representation. So that's something like omega e d d to k 2 pi to the power d f k of r e to the power I omega e minus tau e. This is really nasty, but these are really not very interesting term, plus I k x. So I just Fourier transform. I use a Euclidean signature out there. That's Euclidean space-time. Plug this into that equation of motion, I get something that we start to like. It's now an equation of motion that's entirely depending on a radial coordinate. So it's an ordinary differential equation, and then you get always very happy. Del del r, this looks like as if you're doing quantum mechanics of atoms or something. R force, I just write it here in full because these are kind of the fun equations, bracket closing, dot f k r is 0. Right, so the honest to God ordinary differential equations you can solve, and this one can be solved explicitly. Usually you can't. But now you're really interested in what happens near the ADS boundary. Right, so when you look at this metric, so we discover it just here. R is 0, it's the middle of entity sitter, and R is infinite, is that boundary. I'm interested in this because the only way that anything can communicate between a bulk and a boundary field theory is when I'm near the boundary in the bulk. Right? So this stuff living near the boundary in the bulk has somehow a relation to the field theory. So let me inspect how the simple scalar waves behave near the boundary. ADS has sort of a strange box-like attitude, and there's a universal way that feels asymptote near the boundary. And that is like, wait a moment, yes, you can rescale. Of course, all not very interesting. And you find something that is of this form, a k plus order k over r plus r minus delta bk plus o k over r plus dot 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 dot. These are the leading asymptotes, so r is going to infinite. These are negative exponents. And an important animal is these things automatically pick up an algebraic behavior, and it has exponents that are d over 2 space-time dimension plus square root of d of d squared over 4 plus m squared l squared. Okay. Now, I have here the answer. I know that this is to describe conformal field theory in the stuff, field theory stuff in the boundary. All I have in the bulk that can relate to it is how the stuff in the bulk is asymptoting near that boundary. And I know how that looks like. I can assure you it's rather universal. You always find the same leading and subleading contributions there. This cannot possibly depend on R itself, because R itself is that radial direction, and the boundary field theory cannot have any knowledge about it. So all this information regarding the way that the bulk tells me about the boundary field theory has to sit in these two k-dependent coefficients. And now we just guess. So we know the answer. K is k n omega here, right? So if just combine it, this is just k. And I know that answer. And I want to recover it. This is that thing that I've written there. And the only way to get there is by saying, oh, this has to be the ratio of bk and ak. Right? So bk is, I have forgotten to write it. Just do it here. I get caught by this improvised blackboard. AK is proportional to K D minus delta, and BK is K to the power delta. So when I want to use that knowledge in these two coefficients to reproduce the answer, I need to consider the ratio of the two. Now, you think about your linear response theory, and you realize that bk is the response and ak is the source. So this leading contribution to the asymptote is coding for the source, and the subleading one is coding for the response. Okay. What did I accomplish here? I knew the answer because of Malvasina, and I have worked the way back, departing from the notion that I have to use GR in the bulk, that somehow something has to move there and do there in order to tell me what the boundary field theory wants to do. So I inserted this, is it still there? This, don't like these things. Right, so I inserted just that I have these classical scalar fields propagating the bulk, and I studied that system, and I used the notion that only near the boundary that bulk information can mean anything to the boundary, finding out that there's just one way I can accomplish this. This is actually an official dictionary rule. It's called the B over A rule, and you can derive it from the GKPW principle. And I don't do it here. I back engineer it from having gravitational knowledge. Right, so I have now to, I'm getting really in trouble. I'm just going to explain you very quickly this GKPW rule in a bit more detail. And then I have to respect, because I have to tell you what you buy for it. Right? This application is the real reason that you sit here. And as expected, I get into time trouble. Right, so the groups are Klebanov, Igor, Steve Kupser, Igor Klebanov, the famous Polyakov, Bitten rule is stating that the quantum partition sum of the boundary field CUE is equal to the path integral sum over the bulk action, where the bulk action is in general stringy quantum gravitational hell. Nobody really knows how that works. However, there's a parameter here in front that acts like Kupnikov's n squared. And when that becomes very large, you can get away with classical saddle point. The classical saddle point is GR. Anything gets useful. Now, you want to compute anything from it. And you need to use the following description. So this is really the statements that you need to know. Phi x r to infinite is equal to jx. This is sort of the useful statement. Oops, I'm sweating, hurrying to get it in time. So you want to compute the expectation value in the field theory, that's meaning of these brackets, of a source sourcing a response. And you do that by computing in the bulk such that you have these fields in the bulk corresponding with these operators in the boundary, where you force this field phi at the ADS boundary to be coincident with your source. Right? It's like a magnetic field that you tune in by hand. This is the magnetization response, and it's basically saying when you want to compute it, what you have to do is this field that you switch on in the boundary is constraining that corresponding field in the bulk to take the value at the boundary equal to the response. And now you can just use it as generating functional, right, to compute all types of propagations and so forth. That's the claim, right, of the GPKW. So it's 1 plus 1, I can see this. Yeah.
So you're telling me you can calculate, because this is a equation probably everybody can solve. You can calculate the arbitrary.
That is just the working horse, yeah, yeah.
You can calculate the arbitrary accuracy, yeah. Exponent of the eigenvalues, the 3D eigenvalues.
No, because you have that fucking large n limit. And I think it's not fucking large n.
Right.
I have to explain large n.
Yeah. Okay.
But otherwise it would work. Yeah.
So three different J action and phi x, do we use the action of the P of T or the action of the general?
This is associated with action of the CFT. I call it now Q of T, but I mean CFT. And this is the bulk side where you have the extra dimension.
So you didn't Jx by
the of X bulk? Right, so this is really about, you know, sourcing your quantum field theory, a particular operator in your quantum field theory, right? And that translates into constrained that equivalent field in the bulk that can be part of a, you know, full quantum gravitational problem out here, in principle, when n gets small, such that you constrain the value of phi approaching the boundary that is the leading contribution, this one, to be coincident, you're now looking at this thing really, to be coincident with the source you switch on in the boundary. Right, I give this as sort of the real general abstract. Let me just make this sentence, and that's really time for questions. Departing from this GKPW rule, you can explicitly derive this B of A rule. And the way it works is pretty much like in quantum Hall, right? So when you put a quantum Hall state in a closed manifold, right, you can use just use Jones-Simons, but when you have a boundary in H, you know that you have the boundary H correspondence over gauge transformations. You figure out that you need to include a boundary term at the open boundary, and that's then the Vestermeer-Witten theory describing the H states. Here it works pretty much the same way. Right, so GR is also a gauge theory associated with diffeomorphisms. And then a long time ago by Hawking and co-workers, it was figured out that when you have an ADS space, an open boundary, you have to add these counter terms describing the boundary. You go on shell for large n. That means that your equation of motions solve the bulk actions all become zero, but you have still the boundary action left. You plug in your bulk solutions, and eventually it gives all these observables in the boundary field theory. So it's quite like bulk edge correspondence in quantum Hall. You had a question, right? In order to be practical, n has to be large, and you can get away with the saddle point. That is the secret, right, of this large n limit. No, because that is the large n thing. When n becomes finite, you have a sum of all possible geometries, and nobody really knows how stringy quantum gravity really works, right? It's just a mystery. Right? You take the large n limit, you get a saddle point. The saddle point is classical GR, and then you can do computations. Oops, I'm really getting into trouble. I have to tell you about large n, because that's not something that most condensed matter physicists know. Right, so when we talk about large n, we usually talk about a factor large n theory, where you have a field that has n components. Right? When you take here a large n limit, you basically get to see conventional mean field theory. There's really not much of a difference of pushing d to infinite or n to infinite. You just get mean field as we know it. This is a matrix large n theory, where I basically say my field is a matrix like this. And now I write again the field theory as you expected in terms of the invariance and the lowest numbers of gradients. And this kind of matrix large n matrix theory is really, really very different from vector series. And a typical example is non-abelian Young Mills, where you can think that these fields just correspond to the gluon, so it's like three colors, and there are like eight ways to exchange colors between quarks, so there are 9 minus 1, there has to be traceless quarks, although it's SU3, you have 8 fields. And there's also the origin of this. Then you go back to the 1970s, and my great role model and countryman here, that Hooft, figured out this very, very interesting large n limit. So you can now make the number of entries very large. You think it will become like vector large, but no, forget about it. You can push the coupling to become very, very large. You write out your Feynman diagrams, and they form a net of lines. So when you push the coupling to infinite, the Hooft coupling, you get sort of these vibrating nets that look like strings that describe the real Feynman diagrams. But now, when n is large, it turns out that they are all describing flat surfaces without handles. So the action of large n is to remove the handles. So you have still a very strongly interacting field theory, But these handles are missing, and these handles are basically like the stringy quantum gravity correction. When you do string theory, you start out with sort of flat strings, and you quantize it by having these extra handles and the Torres gravity and quantum gravity. So in the large N limit, you remove these handles, but you're still working with a very, very strongly interacting quantum field theory. Right? So it's a mean field limit, and the mean field is sort of mysteriously related to removing these handles, and then you can describe it in terms of a settle point action that looks in a way very classical, that is like Einstein gravity. Right? So the field theory you describe has nothing to do with this normal mean field. There's a very warped mean field notion. And in a good quantum information language, I won't get to that because I have officially 5 minutes left. It's basically like this kind of mean field is still about vacuum states of matter that are really very strongly long-range entangled. Right? It's not the short-range and entangled Pollock stuff associated with normal mean fields. Are there any questions? Because now I have to rush back to my show and explain you some application in my remaining 5 minutes. I hope you enjoyed it. That gave you some idea about how the machine is really working. So I have the permission to continue showing pictures. And I have now to go very, very fast. Otherwise, there's no time left for... Oops, what did I do with my... Yes, I'm predictable. Okay, so, yeah. The story continues with a piece I would have liked to do in equations on the improvised blackboard, which is about a description of finite temperature matter. The bottom line is, I thought I just described this zero temperature conformal field theory, and I want to know what happens at finite temperature. And the answer is, what you have to do is, temperature breaks scan invariance, GR is RG, so I have to do something with the geometry in the bulk. And the simple solution is, plug in the middle, that encoding for the long wavelength physics, the Schwarzschild black hole that has a horizon, and et cetera. It's really changing the ADS geometry in something else. And now you find out in an extremely beautiful natural way, I really regret that I cannot tell the story, that you look down the boundary, to the meaning of that operation in the bulk, and you find out it just puts the field theory at a finite temperature. It's a purely geometrical thing. So it boils down to, oops, you plug the black hole in the middle, then you look what the metric is doing when you go to the boundary. You're in Euclidean geometry, you find out by the Gibbons-Hawking construction that was known in Euclidean gravity, that at the boundary, the black hole just has the effect of curling the time axis into a circle. And that circle has a temperature associated with it, which is the Hawking temperature of the black hole in the bulk when the bulk would be a quantized affair. It's not. In the same way, you can see all of thermodynamics. Right? So you can compute the free energies of the boundary field theories, you can describe all kinds of phase transitions and so forth. There's one caveat, large N works like large D. So you usually get mean field phase transitions, but we know how to cure it. I should tell you, Jörg, because there's some interplay with your adventure. The real excitement is, when you have a system that lives at a finite temperature, look at long times, in domain translations, it has to form a classical fluid, which is described by the Navier-Stokes theory written down in the 19th century for hydrodynamics. It's a beautiful result that everybody perceives it as the highlight of Minwalla, where you can, in a direct mathematical way, demonstrate that when you start out with the non-stationary new horizon GR, that should code for things happening at long times in the boundary field theory, pull it through the dictionary, and plop, out comes the Navier-Stokes equations. Right, so the Navier-Stokes equations are just encoded by pure general relativity. Okay, I will come back to that. A recent highlight of this is really very, very entertaining stuff. You know that the binary field theory can be, so the hydrodynamics can be tuned easily into a turbulent state by shaking it hard. What means turbulence for the black hole? That was demonstrated by Chesler and Yaffe using numerical GR. It's actually the case that a black hole neo-Riesz geometry turns into a fractal geometry. Right, so turbulence is in 2 plus 1 in two dimensions. It's known to do the Kolmogorov scaling. Right, so it's basically a fractal distribution of vortices in the fluid. And that fractal distribution makes black hole geometry fractal. This was a revelation for the relativists, thinking that black holes could possibly do this kind of complicated stuff. Okay. Let me now go very quickly, because it's really getting time to quit. But I actually have to start with the beef, which is the real condensed matter application. This started around 2009, 2010, and was like, yeah, in condensed matter physics, we would like to know how things work at finite density. What I was explaining there is basically like a ravine, right? But then in a quantum critical form, where you have a chemical potential right at the Dirac node. Now you want to have a finite density out there, right? Departing from the strongly interacting field theoretical stuff. And the dictionary is telling you that you have to plug in an electrical monopole charge in the deep interior of ADS. Right? And this monopole charge goes for how much chemical potential you have. So this was just tried out, and that was the first big, big explosion. So the bottom line is that when you depart from the simplest possible bulk description, Maxwell-Einstein, so you have Einstein theory plus Maxwell for the energy and the matter that you have to do to accommodate a charge. There's just one unique solution, and that's the so-called Riesz-Nordström charge black hole. This was figured out in the 1920s. And this simple object turns out to describe a state of matter in the boundary that's really quite like the strange metals we see in our favorite systems. And I'll explain that a bit more in minutes. At least one aspect that's very similar to the strange metals we see in our favorite systems is these things have a typical attitude that they want to live at low but still quite finite temperatures. These states, these strange metals, are intrinsically extremely unstable objects in a way that we don't recognize from anything we have ever learned. It's like a quantum mechanical instability deep inside. I like to call them quantum frustrated. With the fact that when you cool down, it wants to get unstable in a whole variety of states that we recognize, including superconducting states, including stripy states, electron crystal-like things, and even Fermi liquids. So Fermi liquids are born out of this very non-Fermi liquid strange metal stuff. Right? It is very organically wired into the GR that you have this general behavior of these frustrated metals. They're extremely unstable things. So the simplest of all strange metal is this extremal charged black hole object. So the secret is here that you can actually describe a black hole that has a zero Hawking temperature, and it's an extremal black hole, where all the energy density of the black hole is completely coming from the charge, from the Maxwell fields. Now, when you consider that thing, so you can also make it at finite temperature, then it's no longer extremal. But when you go to the extremal limit, you find out that there's a very beautiful GR miracle occurring there, because you approach the horizon of that Riesz-Nordström black hole and you see that your geometry is completely changed from your ADS, whatever, near the boundary. And what you get here is an emergent geometry that is written as ADS2 times RD, where D is the most space dimension in the field theory. So you see that there's an emergent ADS2, something else than ADS5 or ADS4 associated with the bare conformal theory. And what does this mean? In the plane spanned by radial direction and time, you get an enter-the-sitter geometry. Enter-the-sitter is coding for, I have to shut up, I know, I will go extremely quickly, is coding for scale invariance, but it's now an entirely temporal scale, temporal quantum criticality. So in space direction is smooth, but only in time direction it is quantum critical. This is what is known in condensed matter physics since the 90s as local quantum criticality. Right? That the quantum criticality is of a purely temporal kind. So this was the first surprise. Turns out that this is the tip of the iceberg. You have to do something that is more fancy than Einstein-Maxwell. You have to do Einstein-Maxwell dilaton theory. You can argue that from string theory, that all the long wavelength physics is given by Einstein-Maxwell and dilatons. And dilatons are very scary. I won't explain them to you. The bottom line is, out of these things, you find that invariably, when you go to the deep infrared, the deep interior of the bulk, or the deep infrared of the boundary field theory, you find scalar geometries. They are generalizations of ADS2. They are emergent geometries unrelated to the UV. And these emergent geometries are all the time coded for something that we recognize as quantum critical. Quantum critical in a weird way, because these are quantum critical phases. You don't have to tune to a phase transition to find this emergent scaling variance. It's coming out of the blue all by itself. Perhaps the biggest general message of holography, that when you're dealing with this finite density signful matter, there's a very strong message coming from holography that you want to form quantum critical phases characterized by scaling behaviors that we don't recognize from Boltzmannian / bosonic critical states. One of them is the dynamic critical exponent that can become so large, this local quantum criticality saying. There are more. There's a charge exponent I don't want to talk about. The thing that I like most is what's called hyperscaling violation exponent. That basically saying that the number of degrees of freedom available to do your statistical physics and so forth is no longer scaling with the volume of your system. Right? So you have an entropy that scales like you expect to scale it like t to the power d divided by c, but this space image gets now corrected by this hyperscaling violation exponent. I see that Flat gets very impatient. Let's go extremely quick just to give you an impression how well it all works. So I told you, you have these natural instabilities towards states of matter that we recognize, like superconductors and Fermi liquids. On the gravitational side, this works in a very funny way. You find out that typically these charged black hole-like objects, when you try to push them to zero temperature, have an appetite to become unstable as gravitational objects. And what they want to do is, they want to uncollapse in a star. Right, so you know that black holes are formed by collapsing stars. This is uncollapsing stars. But the black hole is unstable. That is instability associated with strange metals. And these star-like objects describe generically states of matter that we understand. Example is the first one discovered in 2008, holographic superconductor. You put in a scalar field, much of the time as I discussed there. It's a complex scalar. It's called a Higgs field. You know from string theory that's there. And you find out that when you lower temperature at some point, the black hole gets an atmosphere of finite scalar hair that is hanging around the black hole. Now you see how these fields behave, and you find, is there still my A over B rule? You find that actually the asymptote now such that the leading component, the source, is vanishing, and the response is still there. So you have a vet without a source and a definition of spontaneous symmetry breaking. Turns out that this is a perfectly sane form of superconductor. To give an example, here is the thermal evolution of this superconducting order problem. It just looks like BCS. And it is firmly embedded in top-down construction. It's really rolling out of string theory. We know it has to happen in real theories that might not be realized by earthly matter. And that holographic superconductor is doing all the tricks a normal superconductor is doing. You can do holographic Josephson junctions, there's holographic zero sound. Whatever you have ever dreamed about for a normal superconductor is happening in these things as well. The Fermi liquid is similar, except that now you uncollapse the black hole into a thing that is really like a star. It is basically like a neutral star that's now electrically charged, called an electron star. Now, to give a very short impression of how it works. So tune a parameter that makes the black hole uncollapse in the star at zero temperature. Now we look at EDCs of the fermion responses. It's just like photon emission, inverse photon emission. This is right at KF. Here's no Fermi surface. And bang, the star forms a plop. You get a beautiful cluster particle at KF. I see the chairman really gets impatient. He's right about it. This was a transport piece. I leave this to Philip. Philip, you have first Philip. I don't see him. There's Philip. You have to do the transport piece. And there is also the entanglement piece that I love most. And this is about entanglement entropies. This explains hyperscaling violation. This is telling us that these strange metals described at zero temperature states that are, because of fermion science, extremely densely entangled. And we have a picture to explain it that has to do with the nodal structure. This is just coming from Google image. This is not serious. But this is serious. We are claiming that this can be explained in terms of a fractal distribution of the nodes of the wave function, which is a signful thing. And the evidence is that we can compute the second Rengier entropy, that's the Lighting van Neumann entropy, doing the same kind of weird hyperscaling violation as you pick up in the strange metals. And this you can ask me during beer time or something, because my chairman will otherwise kill me because I'm late by 10 minutes. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you very much.